You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host as always, Billy. And yes, if you are watching these in chronological order, I have shaved my beard and shaved the head, trimmed the beard. The next week's episode looks wildly different because I have not done either of those things. But I am joined on this edition by a man who's got so many hats in wrestling, so many caps, he could open a very nice hat shop and probably make a good wee profit on it. I'm joined by the author of One Fall to a Finish, Inside the British Wrestling Boom Years and Beyond, along with many other books that we're going to mention, by Greg Lambert. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me, Billy. Great to be here.
I'm very excited, but it's like I was saying, just as we're off recording, these have been on my to read lists for many years, so I'm glad there's a third in the trilogy and I can just read them all one by one. I don't edit, it's fine. So I'm excited about this. And in One Fall to Finish, it finishes a trilogy of books over a 20-year period of British wrestling. How's that journey been for you in the briefest of terms? Because I know that it's going to be covered in three volumes of a book of books here. But yeah, how's that journey been for you?
Personally, it's been quite a journey, really. I sometimes have to pinch myself, I think, to think that I actually managed to get involved in British wrestling at such a time when it was, you know, kind of a historically significant time, really, I think, you know, with the fact that it had been on national television since the 50s to the 80s, then it was taken off. And then there was that period of time where it was kind of in the doldrums. And then it was just starting to spring back into life when I got involved. And then kind of you had sort of what I did in it, but also the, you know, running parallel to that, the story of this group of men and women in British wrestling, you know, hungry group of people trying to get it back to that position that it was in. So, you know, I think my journey sort of runs side by side with that. I think that sort of wider goal, I think, for a lot of people.
For me, getting into independent wrestling, it was 2012. That was my first ever Scottish wrestling show. And even in that 12-year period, the landscape has changed so much. But you were there a little bit before then, so you saw, like you said, the doldrums, the bit where everyone was just trying to get to the building a foundation for a better future, I suppose, the best way to put it. So how did you end up getting involved? Was it just by chance? I know you've got a journalist broadcasting background as well. So yeah, how did it all come together?
It was by chance, really. I was a fan of American wrestling mainly, although I had watched the sort of tail end of the world of sport on ITV in the 80s, you know, the famed Big Daddy and Giant Haystacks era, for want of a better term. And I was kind of aware of some of the British independent wrestling promotions around about the sort of the turn of the century we're talking about. And the one in particular that was kind of grabbing people's attention and getting a little bit of coverage in the wrestling magazines at the time was the FWA. And the FWA was run by Alex Shane. And Alex Shane also was on a national radio show on TalkSport with the children's TV presenter Tommy Boyd. And they hosted to my knowledge, I think it's still the only ever national radio show totally dedicated to professional wrestling. And I started listening to that on a Saturday night, and they were promoting this big show and they were really heavily pushing it on the radio, and they were calling it Revival, taking place at the Crystal Palace Indoor Arena in February 2002 with Eddie Guerrero as the main attraction on the bill. And this was during the period of time between Eddie Guerrero's two stints with think it was still the WWF at the time. So Eddie was a big draw, and I really wanted to go and see him. And I think Brian Christopher, Grandmaster Sexy, was on the show as well. And again, he'd sort of come off his big run with Too Cool at the time, so he was a big name. And there was a lot of the British wrestlers that I didn't know quite so much about. You know, people like Jody Fleisch, Johnny Storm, Doug Williams, Alex himself, and quite a few others. And they just pushed this show week in, week out on the radio. And I just thought, I've got to go and see this show. They were kind of saying, look, you just need to be here. You'll tell your grandparents about this show. This is going to be the revival of British wrestling. It's going to come back to prominence with this show. So I went down there, and that's where I kind of became hooked on the modern day British wrestling. And then from there, the stars all just sort of aligned. I met Alex at the show. He asked me to get involved with the radio show. He asked me to get involved with the FWA eventually. And around about the same year, I got a job writing for Power Slam magazine. Again, you know, through my journalistic background, I just qualified as a journalist. It just all came together in 2002. And I look back at it now and I just think, how did that all happen? It was just crazy. And then it all kind of carried on from there.
And the amazing thing about that is nowadays, I mean, I would love to be able to just go, I've done all this kind of things, but social media makes that kind of jump maybe a little bit easier. Whereas 2002, there was maybe MySpace in its infancy, but it was really radio, talking to people, magazines, and I remember having so many issues of Power Slam and PWI and all that kind of stuff, just stacked, reading it every month. And that was, and you had the back pages. I remember the back pages for tape trading as well. It seems so primitive, but it was actually, it seemed a bit more of a, a more collective way to network. And you make those connections like you did with Alex Shane, and then eventually Power Slam, FWA. It's a fascinating time. And as an outsider, I would have been 12 around about that time, so I would have had the Power Slam magazines. I would have had the magazines every month as I could. Hearing about the FWA and seeing it, these pictures and everything, it seemed fascinating, that British wrestling was. And the only exposure to it maybe before going to my first show was the Wrestling Channel, if anyone remembers that's watching or listening. So for yourself, getting into it, you've met Alex Shane, you got involved. Did you realise how fascinating the British wrestling scene was, or were you already quite fascinated as soon as you heard about this FWA show that Alex was talking about?
Yeah, I was already quite fascinated because Revival was a big success. It was actually aired on the Bravo channel, which was, I don't think it exists anymore, but it was one of the bigger satellite TV channels at the time, a delayed version. So it went out on a form of British TV, which at the time was very rare for a British wrestling show. And this was maybe a year or two before the Wrestling Channel, which you talked about, which again, in a similar vein to the Talk Wrestling Radio Show, the only ever channel purely dedicated to professional wrestling in this country, available in this country, 20 years ago. Hasn't been anything since, I don't think. So yeah, I mean, at the time, are we taking this for granted? I'm not sure, because I look back at it now and I think there were so many things going on back then that were pretty groundbreaking and pioneering and special. But yeah, the FWA definitely felt special because the shows were getting decent crowds. You know, I say decent crowds around about that time. You know, 2000 is a massive crowd. That's what Revival got, or thereabouts. I think they started running some shows at the York Hall, and they were getting, again, about 1,000. Again, big crowds for the time. And just bringing over some big names, and names that went on to become, you know, massive stars today. You know, the CM Punk made his European debut for the FWA. AJ Styles, when he was a younger man, Brian Danielson. These were the kind of names that were coming over for both FWA and you know, All Star as well, and other promotions in the UK around about that time. So you look back now and you think, wow, it was a massive deal. But at the time, it did feel pretty special too.
A lot of this, what we're talking about right this second, will be covered in Holy Grail. I no doubt assume. Say my copy's on the way, and I will find out. So yeah. I won't spoil people too much about your story in that respect, because people can go and get a copy of Holy Grail, and they probably should. And I'm ashamed that it's taken me this long to actually get a copy in my I was gonna say bookshelf, but I have one in the background there. So yeah, I'm looking forward to reading that and finding out your story more in that respect. So there's a lot of, what made you decide that Holy Grail was the book? Why did you decide to start documenting this? Is it a long time coming? What was the reason for it?
I think I started writing Holy. I mean, got to remember, it's a long time ago. Mm-hmm. I actually think Holy Grail's quite dated now, and I sort of look at it and I think it's not the same person that wrote that at all. I don't recognise the person who wrote that, if I'm being honest, because mm-hmm. you know, we're covering a period which ended in 2007 in Holy Grail, which is, you know, it's nearly two decades ago. So what I think prompted me to write it at the time was probably the end of the FWA. The FWA finishing, although there was a brief resurrection, which is covered in the second book, that the main FWA that, you know, longer time British wrestling fans will remember ended in 2007. And it was the need to document that period of time. I wasn't sure if anybody else would, and I didn't want such a historic period in the history of independent wrestling in Britain to be forgotten. So, and I also felt I wanted to tell my story, because I ended up running the FWA. Now, I'd been a manager. I'd been a heel manager was my main role when I came into the FWA, but I ended up the last year actually in charge of it. And it was a difficult period. And I just felt that I wanted my story documented, and, you know, to explain some of the reasons of some of the things I did. But also, it was a great story. So many ups and downs, so many mad incidents and mistakes, which make for a good read, I think, sometimes. And a lot of people, I actually prefer Ropes and Glory to Holy Grail, because Ropes and Glory is a more positive book, and I feel it's a more mature book in the way it's written, because it's a person writing it 8 or 9 years after Holy Grail. But the feedback I've had is more people prefer Holy Grail, because they just love that, you know, they love the they love to read about things going wrong, and you know, the incidents, the mad incidents that happened along the route.
But yeah, I'm not gonna lie. That's kind of the reason why I want to start there and then just work my way through. Because the boom, I got into it, like I said, 2012 was when I found out there was wrestling. Because before then, it was tribute shows. The last show I went to prior to 2012 was 2001, and it was a tribute show in Elgin. And it was, I have so little memory of it. I only remember there was a fake Mankind. That is it. That's all my memory is of that show. And it's irritated me for a long time, because if someone was doing something about that tribute shows that went around Scotland and like collated, documented it like you did with the FWA, then I would love to know more about it. But I think that's kind of what, when I started this whole thing, Scottish Wrestling Network and all that kind of stuff, I had the same thought of, I want people to know what happened during this time. It's not like a dirt sheet or anything like that, but it's like, this is the results. This is what happened. This is how we thought and felt at the time for these shows. And I think it's important that people do that. And for yourself, that's went out your way to document it and put it in written form or Kindle form or whoever it's distributed. It's a very important thing to do, because, I mean, not everyone has access to the internet. Not everyone has access to this information, but you have it there for us at the time. Yeah, so Ropes and Glory. It was the second book. It was around about, it was the boom. It was when wrestling, 2014-ish, is when it started to proper explode to be a mainstream thing. As someone who's seen it just travel up, was there a bit of were you just proud to see that happen? And of course, you've documented it down again. But were you proud to see the wrestling was becoming a bit more of a respect thing in the world and to everyone's eyes?
Very much so. Yeah. And I think, you know, the level of talent that we had and have, you know, in wrestling in Britain. I think it was very well deserved. I think that we had a number of wrestling promotions that became really hot at the same time, you know, on the indie scene. I think at the time, in the period that we're talking about, the four that really stood out, and I think I'd call them the big four at the time in Ropes and Glory, would have been ICW in Glasgow, Progress, Revolution Pro, and PCW, which I was, you know, lucky enough to work for 10 years. And, you know, each very different, but each contributed to, you know, helping to continue, I suppose, where the FWA had left off, and other promotions as well, in making British wrestling cool, and also in attracting an overseas audience as well. And you talked before about social media, which wasn't around during the FWA era, and YouTube wasn't really around during the FWA era. Streaming wasn't around, but those things were coming to the fore to make, you know, the world a smaller place and make it easier to access entertainment and sport that you want to watch. And, you know, obviously British wrestling is no different. And I think that's where you started to see the growth of the overseas interest in, you know, British wrestling becoming popular with wrestling fans around the world, as well as in this country.
And certainly for Scotland anyway, Grado being probably one of the big deals, and using YouTube and using that marketing to get himself across. People go, oh, I want to see this Grado guy do some wrestling. Of course, being the cover star of Ropes and Glory as well. But things like, right by that time, what was it, TNA came over, they started their UK tours, their then yearly UK tours. They brought in Lionheart for a moment. I know there's a tribute to Lionheart in One Fall to Finish as well, that I want to bring up because it's coming up to 5 years since his unfortunate passing as well. And it's just shocking to see that not shocking, that's not the word, but it's just, can't believe it's been 5 years, first of all. But the fact that wrestling has changed so much in that time as well, since Lionheart's passing, is also just fascinating at the same time. But for yourself and Lionheart, like I said, there's tribute in One Fall to Finish, so people can read it. But meeting Lionheart for the first time, did you kind of feel? I know there's a reputation whether Lionheart takes a little bit of time to warm up to between meeting and friendship. But what were your thoughts meeting Adrian for the first time?
I think it would have been at an FWA show back in 2009, and I think it probably. Our paths didn't really cross very much after that for a few years, until I came into PCW in 2012 as the commentator. And Adrian was already, I mean, he'd been, 1PW, I think, had been Adrian's, you know, the company that really kind of, you know, that Adrian was synonymous with in England, certainly. But yeah, PCW, he became synonymous with, he was already becoming one of PCW's main guys, and that was the case, you know, for the next few years. And we developed a very good and very mutually respectful working relationship. We were, you know, very, very friendly to each other. You know, we weren't close friends, but we were, you know, we saw each other every month for about 6 years. You know, we worked very closely together, you know, both when I was a commentator, and then even more so for the last couple, you know, 2 or 3 years of his life. I was the matchmaker at PCW, so, you know, as the booker of PCW, and Lionheart being three-time PCW champion as he was, we would have a lot of interaction, you know, a lot of really good, positive conversations. I always felt, and I write this in the book, didn't have to give Adrian very much in terms of bullet points of what, you know, it was only bullet points in terms of what I'd like him to do, my vision of what I wanted to see on that particular show. And he'd just go out and nail it every single time. Consummate pro, really great guy. And I remember the phone call on that day when I was told that he'd passed away, and yeah, just felt numb, just felt disbelieving, really. And like you said, it's nearly 5 years. It doesn't feel like 5 years. The great thing is, I mean, he isn't forgotten. He shouldn't be forgotten. He touched so many lives, you know, people he trained, fans, colleagues, obviously, you know, the people who were the closest to him. And I just wanted to make sure in this book that he was remembered, you know, that I wrote a chapter dedicated to him, you know, kind of exploring a bit more my relationship with him and some of the things that he did in his career. And he was one of the greats, as far as I'm concerned, of British wrestling. Unquestionably one of the greats.
Feel like that maybe some fans, maybe not a whole lot of fans, but some people didn't realize what we'd lost until it was gone, kind of thing. I think maybe people took Lionheart for a little bit for granted as, oh, it's Lionheart, he's going to put on a decent match, he's going to be absolutely blistering on the microphone, and then when he went away, he just went, that's, yeah, it's one of those things that, like I say, 5 years later, as a fan myself, seeing it pop up on whatever social media it was, and it's someone who'd only ever seen him wrestle live twice, and that was only in the last couple of years. Yeah, it was that just that numbness, and I can't imagine how people that actually spoke to him or knew him personally had felt at the time. But he's been part of many historic moments in British wrestling and Scottish wrestling as well. Good and bad. The AJ Styles neck break being an example, being something that rocked wrestling in general, and I suppose by hook or by crook brought focus into the British wrestling scene because of it, which just goes to show the power that Lionheart had or has still in wrestling. To move on
And
to
just sorry, Billy, just on, obviously I was there that night. I was commentating, and that's something that, you know, should be remembered about Adrian as well. The way that he came back after that was absolutely incredible and inspirational. The way that he, you know, came back and had such a great, you know, I think that, you know, would have inspired a lot of people as well. And, you know, I did feel like he was a really inspiring guy in a lot of ways.
And he went on to main event in the Hydro and against Jackie Polo, and yeah, he's just I'm glad that there's something's written that again written in form, so there's a tribute to him because he shouldn't be forgotten in wrestling, in general. To maybe go into a bit of a lighter subject for myself, anyway, as a fascinated fan of it. You mentioned in One Fall to the Finish, five star wrestling, which. As you've said in
Knew this
the
was coming.
press, yeah. As you said in your press release, you did talk about it. I'm just trying to get the quote right in front of me here. Just how your exact wording of it was, for the madness of five star wrestling. And now I can't see it now. Now I'm looking for it. There you go.
Barely believable, I think, is the
Barely
phrase
believable.
that
That is the phrase I'm
I, yeah.
literally going in front of me now. I was fascinated by this whole journey as someone who watched it on TV. I wrote about did like reviews on it. It was one of those shows where it was so madcap that you watch it and go, "How is any of this happening?" You would go into detail in it by the book, as the blurb says. So I don't want again, don't want to spoil it too much for people. But is you've put barely believable. Was there any moment where you just literally sat there with Joe Hendry? Of course, who is streaming on Twitch, sitting there going, what has my life become?
There were many moments when that happened over those 5 weeks, and like you say, Billy, it's in the book. You know, I mean, there's not a lot I can say really on this interview. I mean, I can't. There's no way I could possibly do it justice. Is that the right phrase? There's no way I could possibly, you know, even summarize it, I think. You know, I just think that the book is probably the first time that the story has been told. In detail, in terms of what actually happened, because I was right at the center of it. And again, I have this habit. I had this habit in my life and in my wrestling career in particular, where I kind of start out doing a role that I quite enjoy doing, and then somehow, and it's my own fault, I end up volunteering or getting sucked into a different role, which I really don't enjoy. And that, you know, the FWA, I mentioned, I touched on that a little bit earlier, you know, started out as a heel manager and then ended up running it. And we ended up deciding to shut it down because it wasn't really succeeding like it used to. And with Five Star, I started out as commentator. My first experience of Five Star was the, I don't know if you remember, the live special in Dundee in 2017.
Oh, I remember that. Yes, I do.
Now, do you know what? From a commentator, from being on a, you know, from commentating and hosting a live television show, the first live television show by a British wrestling company in 50 years, I had an amazing experience that day. I don't know. I can't speak for anybody else, but that, I actually write in the book, it's probably my favorite ever experience in wrestling.
I think
because they treated us so well. They put us up in a beautiful hotel and working with top level talent, you know, the likes of Rey Mysterio, Nick Aldis, Carlito, Drew Galloway, Drew McIntyre. It was brilliant that day. Absolutely top guy. Actually, it was Drew who rang me up in the first place and asked me if I would do it. You know, that's the level we're talking. And I loved that. I loved that. But then because I could see as the TV series was getting underway, there were glaring holes in the organization. I put myself forward to try and help. And in a way, thank goodness I did, because it makes for a great book. But in another way, it's like, why did I do that? It's probably part of the, no, I was actually already bald, but it was a very stressful time.
It's one of those, I remember the whole hubbub about it at the time, because of course another promotion in Dundee was trying to cause an invasion on it, well, so much of an invasion on it, which I don't know if it's going to be mentioned. We had a British wrestling show that featured, I think, two British wrestlers, which, and then the tournament. It's just, yeah, it was fascinating to watch from the outside. I can only imagine what it's going to be like. Well, you can't just only imagine. You can buy the book and read it and find out how it was on the inside. So that's
the Belfast chapter is the best one. That's all I'll say.
So just from my own memory, again, I know that you're not going to spoil it because you've got a book to everyone needs to read. But just the thoughts, Jake Hager's promo, Rey Mysterio competing for a tap and snap championship and not doing any submission moves, so that was lifted. Bram finishing with the two finger salute, sorry, double middle fingers, and that was the end of Five Star Wrestling, which is a beautiful ending chapter of a show. Plymouth being probably the best show because it was a small
game.
It's if anyone who's maybe wanting to get some TV wrestling on TV, on the outset, Five Star looks like a promotion that you can learn from in many ways. But all I've heard from anyone who worked on it, I've spoke to a few guys that have, is everyone got paid. And I think that's probably the most important thing in the end of the day. So
I didn't.
Oh.
Well, no. Well, I did to a certain extent. But all I can say is, if you think you know the story, you don't. But when you read one talk fall to a finish, you will.
So there you go. There's a big push. If you're ever going to want to know more about Five Star Wrestling, and I do, it'll be in my Amazon basket before you know it. And also, you talked about the World Sport revival as well on ITV, which was, again, another fascinating show. I feel like for wrestling fans watching those kind of things, I can easily sit here and go, I know how you do this better, but I suppose things happen, and people that are actually in the middle of it are trying to maneuver things to work, and it just doesn't happen that way. But for the two, WOS and Five Star, it's just sitting there, just going, what's happening? The kind of thing. But WOS is fascinating as well. From your experience, what? Yeah. Nuggets can you give us about that?
Well, you can't compare the two.
Right.
WOS was actually, I mean, I wasn't part of the TV taping, so just to make that clear, first of all, I wasn't there for the pilot in 2016, and I wasn't there for the recording of the 10-part TV series in 2018, but I have spoken to a lot of people for the book who were there. And I was also working very closely with the team who wrote the TV series at the time, which was, again, Alex Shane, Dan Richardson, and I think they were the main two. I think Rich Dunn was involved as well from NGW, but I was working very closely with them at the time because I was working, doing a lot of work for WrestleTalk and various other things that that they were involved in at NGW as well. This is 2018. So organisationally, NGW, and there's a chapter in the book called Night and Day, and it's basically explaining me coming out of Five Star and starting to work for NGW, who were heavily involved in WOS. Organisationally, it is night and day to Five Star. NGW is probably the most organised, well-organised, best organised, best run, most professional wrestling promotion I've ever worked for. And that was what they were, the main wrestling, you know, driving force behind WOS. So behind the scenes, it was quite smooth. I mean, you had the thing with, obviously it was ITV show, but there was wrestling people who knew what they were doing, who were running, who were putting that, you know, putting that show together from a creative standpoint. But the ratings don't lie. And a massive amount of people turned off between week one and the final show, week 10, which ironically was probably the best episode of the series. And it had all been building towards, I don't know if you remember, Justin Sisom, Rampage Brown for the WOS title, a really good, you know, show long storyline. But as the book says, it lost 1 million people in terms of, you know, audience between week one and week 10. So WOS sadly was, it just didn't it didn't work out. It never came back, which is a real shame. And there's lots of reasons why, there's lots of opinions why, and a lot of different opinions in the book. But I just think ultimately the product just wasn't what enough people wanted to see at the end of the day. It didn't really appeal to hardcore wrestling fans. The shame was is that we went out on the WOS tour, which I was involved in early 2019. That was a massive success. We ran six venues, all sold out or near as it could be. Great response to all the British wrestlers. They were treated like stars by the fans. Very much a family audience. And we came out of that thinking WOS has got legs. You know, there could be a second series, but it wasn't to be.
It's at least it was better than ITV's Celebrity Wrestling. But yeah,
that was way better. Way better.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean,
that was a wrestling.
Another thing I still love ITV Celebrity Wrestling. For as terrible as it was, it's one of those things where you watch it a different way, watching it going, how did this get made? I did a wee 30-minute documentary like 2 years ago because I just sat there one day and went, I wonder how much I could find of ITV Celebrity Wrestling, and the answer is not a lot. So yeah, made a little like 30-minute documentary about it because it was just how wrong could you make it, you know? And anyway, I don't know if you cover that in any of the trilogy, but
it's in Holy Grail.
Oh yes, come on Amazon, get this delivered so I can read it. So you talked about you spoke to a lot of people for the books to get their kind of side of the story or their opinions at the time. Was there any particular group of people that you spoke to that really surprised you with their story, that surprised you, that you may not have thought of at the time, that really kind of went, my God, this is going to be a fantastic story to put in, but at the same time going, my God, I can't believe that happened as well?
Surprised? Certainly not. No, not for one fall to a finish. No, because, I mean, you've got to remember that I've been privileged enough to know these people that I've interviewed. I've worked with these people. And I think that's enabled, you know, that's opened the door to be able to have these really kind of open, frank conversations with them, and for them to, you know, tell their stories and give their perspective on, you know, what they see of what's happened in British wrestling. I think that every single one of them in this book have got a really interesting story to tell and different perspectives. You've got some people, you know, I speak to SoCal Val, who's brilliant. Val is such a great person to work with. I've got such great memories of working with Val. And Val is a beacon of positivity. So, you know, Val's got nice things to say about five-star wrestling in Belfast. You know, she'll have a glass is half full with Val all the time, and that's great. You know, I've always tried to be like that. It's you know, I've been ground down a little bit over the years, but I've always tried to be like that where I can. But you know, you've also got, you know, Mark Haskins is what a talented wrestler he is, and I've interviewed him for the book, and he's got some really interesting things to say, some really interesting insight into the, you know, working for Progress and ICW and IPW UK and Defiant, and, you know, a lot of the promotions that were doing big things around the time, a lot of the independent wrestling promotions, and also being on the Progress Wembley show as well in 2018. What a big year that was. Mark was there, so, you know, he's got some insight into what happened there. Justin Sison, you know, the guy who ended the first ever series on ITV wrestling for nearly 30 years as the champion, who's now not in wrestling anymore and has never looked back because he's got an amazing career as a TV and film stuntman, and he's doing fantastically well. That's an interesting story. You know, he was the poster boy for family-friendly wrestling, for TV wrestling, 5 or 6 years ago, and now he's not even involved anymore, and that's his own choice. He's making a great living and doing really well and appearing in some big movies. Zach Knight, he's in the book, you know, talking about that, you know, British wrestling in the movies. What?
I know.
What's the real story that is? Fighting with my family and the success of that. And, you know, the nights after all the work and toil they put in over, you know, going back 30 years. So, you know, now Zach's in AEW with his sister and, yeah, achieving his ambition, which is fantastic. So yeah, there's a lot of nothing that really surprised me, but there's a lot of really interesting insight from the people. I thank every single one of them and everybody who's contributed to my books.
It's amazing to think that this small island, this collective island of UK and Ireland, in fact, can't forget Ireland because they've got a fascinating tale of their own. That seems to be my buzzword for this particular episode. Is so much has happened and been packed in that 20 years. It's almost incredible to think that, I mean, we haven't even touched upon things like what culture and things like that, and ICW in the Hydro. We talked about it a little bit for Lionheart, Jackie Polo, but that was huge, and Drew coming back and really kickstarting everything, and it's just so, and NXT UK, having mentioned that as well, it's so much has happened that's caused some positive and negative, case NXT UK perhaps, that in the wrestling landscape in such a short period of time. It makes you kind of look back and go, I mean, I've been doing this website for over 10 years now, thinking how much has changed in that short amount of time. You speak about in the blurb about things like COVID, speaking out and all that kind of stuff. And I suppose for Holy Grail is probably a little bit about the good and bad. Mainly everyone's going to buy it for the bad. And then Ropes and Glory is about the positivity and the explosion of British wrestling. For One Fall to a Finish, did you feel like it was a bit more of a mixed bag of positivity, and along with things that may have balanced out British wrestling from the boom that it was having?
I don't know. I'd actually think that the best analogy I could probably give you, you know, if you're a Star Wars fan, is that I think I've written The Empire Strikes Back at the end of the trilogy.
Oh, it makes for good reading. I'm not going to say that.
I genuinely do. I think that Holy Grail's quite... The spirit and the tone of Holy Grail is somebody, I think, who is still as an author is still fighting against the odds. You know, we are the underdogs. We're quite defiant in British wrestling, and we're trying and scratching and crawling and trying to get to the top of that mountain. And then Ropes and Glory is a bit more triumphant. It's Return of the Jedi. We're at the top of the mountain. And I guess from there, there's only one way you can go. And yeah, I actually found it really hard to release One to Fall to a Finish, because I'd be interested to see what the reviews are coming in. I'm pleasantly surprised that people don't think it, haven't said, oh God, this didn't have a finish on a downer. and maybe it doesn't. Maybe people are kind of, you know, bringing, you know, finding a bit of positivity in the end of it. But I must admit, as writing it, it was very hard for me to bring myself to release it, because it was quite a difficult period, I think, you know, seeing British wrestling have these opportunities and attain these opportunities, and then just kind of them not really go the way that everybody had hoped. And then, like you say, there was what happened in 2020. And then coming back, I personally never felt the same. And, you know, as you'll read the book, you will discover, through my own choice, I'm no longer involved in British wrestling. This thing that I was, you know, so passionate and such a champion about. My last show was October 2022. I've not done anything since then, and it's been mainly through my own choice, you know, commitments in my own life, other things happening. But I don't massively miss it. And I look back at 20 years and I think, why do I feel like this? And I think the last couple of chapters, there's a lot of me exploring those feelings. And I'd be interested to see what people think of it.
It's you're right. It's not the same as it was pre-2020. And as someone who's trying to navigate just stuff north of the border, it's still a very tense scene still. And I don't know what it's going to take to loosen. Well, I do know what it's going to take to loosen it, but that's a whole different podcast, and it's probably going to end up with a lot of letters at my door for things that I shouldn't say. But it's there's still such a tension in British wrestling. But if we try to look at the positives, the last two years or so, we've seen AEW come over and sell an undetermined amount of tickets, possibly over 70,000, but we're not entirely sure. Don't ask Will Ospreay, because he won't be happy about the answer. We've got WWE coming over for Clash of the Castle. They'll be back in the Hydro in a couple of weeks as well, which is incredible. We've had TNA come back for their UK tour for Maximum Impact last year. So feels like the I don't know if it feels like it's healing a bit more, that these international companies are deciding UK scene as a viable option again to come back and try and take a piece of the pie. We'll try to look at it in a positive slant. Or they're vultures picking over the remains. I don't know. That's something that people can decide themselves. But when you say you're out of the game now, that's you, Dan. You've done your trilogy, you've done your original trilogy, your New Hope, your Empire, and your Return. Is there a Phantom Menace? Are you going to go back any further, or are you quite happy just to leave the memories alone and that's it done?
That's it done. Yeah, without a doubt. Three is always a nice number. Three is the right number, I think. No, nobody talks about a quadrilogy, do they?
Right.
So I don't even know if it's a word. So yeah, I'm quite happy leaving it at, as De La Soul said, three is the magic number.
I can confirm. Well, I've only ever seen the word quadrilogy written down once, and that was when it was a Die Hard box set, when it officially got booted out of my top trilogy of movies of all time. They released a fourth, and out it went. So keep it as an Austin Powers or Back to the Future, and just keep it as a perfect three. Of what a wildly differing trilogy of movies that I've chosen there. But
it is, yeah.
But there are perfect trilogies, and I'll fight anyone who argues about Austin Powers with me about it. But looking for your own journey, you'll say you've finished the chapter, you're three, you're done, you're happy. Do you still watch the scene? Do you still keep involved as a viewer, as a fan, or as they say, you other things? Is that it? Is that you've stepped away as much as you possibly could from British wrestling?
I think there was a period of time where I wasn't really watching very much at all, but I think that's changed, and I think that's a good thing. I think it's nice to be able to get back to just enjoying it as a fan, because I think when you're inside the bubble of anything, it's not just wrestling. I mean, I know people who, you know, work in music, and it's exactly the same there, and boxing as well. You know, it's very hard to see, you know, the wood for the trees, I think. You know, get a really, you know, step back and take a proper perspective on things. And I'm pleased to say that, you know, particularly around, you know, the start of this year and WrestleMania, I was really, really enjoying watching WWE again. I think, you know, it has massively improved, hasn't it? And AEW, not so much, I have to admit. Not this year. I think I was enjoying it. I think when CM Punk came back and did his big feud with MJF, I think I was really enjoying it then. I always like watching what the Brits are doing. You know, I like keeping an eye on what Will Ospreay's doing, what Drew is doing in WWE, what Piper Niven is up to, and Nikki Cross. You know, I always keep an eye on what all, you know, the people I've worked with are up to, and it's great to see. And the great thing, and I say it in the book, there's more British wrestlers now making a living than there's ever been. You know, yeah, they've had to mainly go overseas to do it after the short period of time with NXT UK and you know, and that sort of period around about that time when they were able to, you know, earn a good salary in this country, but. You know, there's so many doing such a great job, and I keep an eye on what they're doing. But I'm just enjoying being a fan. Following the British scene, though, I find it so weird and so hard to say, Billy, because I used to just follow everything. I used to know the ins and outs, every nook and cranny of everything that was going on, and I really couldn't tell you much. I keep a little bit of an eye, but I really couldn't tell you much of what's happening. And I just hope that from what I can gather, you know, there's still a lot of talent still, and a lot of great promotions doing a lot of great things. And I just hope the goal now, you know, whereas our goal was to kind of get British wrestling back on top, I just hope that, you know, the people who are around today are just as hungry to build it back up again.
Yeah, and well, someone who's trying to keep a track of the Scottish scene up here, it's ridiculous. Yeah, there's so many things happening, and then so many things you don't want to speak about, and so many things that you want to try and focus on. And, yeah, it's just, there's so much. But again, we're not dwelling on the negativity. We'll pick it back up with, before we do the big closer, big final push, the selling, the big plugging. Let's just lighten the mood a little bit with has there ever been a moment where you've met a wrestler in your time, your journey, that either you've made a bit of a fool of yourself, being a bit overzealous, being maybe fanboying a bit too much? Has there ever been a wrestler that you've met and went, oh my God, I'm meeting you?
Not really. I don't think so, because I think being, you know, from my sort of journalistic background, I've met a lot of, you know, famous people, celebrities, and interviewed a lot over the years. And I think the more you do it, you just realize they're people. You know, it's not, you just have conversations with them as you would do any normal other person. There is a story in the book in Five Star Wrestling where I am so stressed backstage in Newcastle that I go into catering, and because we did actually have catering from week two in Five Star Wrestling. And I actually accidentally dropped a full roast chicken on the floor in front of John Morrison. because I was so kind of, I would think I was shaking. I probably hadn't eaten all day, and I'd probably been like being pulled in about 20 different directions, and probably something had happened that had annoyed me or stressed me out backstage. And so I couldn't actually physically, I don't know why I was picking up a full roast chicken, but I obviously did. And it went all over the floor in front of John Morrison. That's probably the closest you're going to get, Billy, I think.
Yeah, well, if anyone wants to know more, we'll talk about One Fall to a Finish, Inside the British Wrestling Boom Years and Beyond, available exclusively at the moment on Amazon in both paperback and ebook. Go back and check that out. You can also go get Holy Grail, even though the Greg has said it's not his best work. We'll be the judge of that. And Ropes and Glory, which has been wildly praised by reviewers all over the world as well. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. For anyone who's listened to this so far and is thinking they're still on the fence about buying this or any of your other books, is there anything that you want to just tell them, grab them by the throat and go, this is why you should buy this book?
If you're a fan of British wrestling, this is the story of the last 20 years. It's really that simple. You're not going to get it in any more depth and any more in any more detail, and written by somebody who was right at the center of it, and spoke to and has spoken to some of the biggest names who made British wrestling what it became. So this if you're a British wrestling fan, all three of them need to be on your shelf. It's that simple. If you want to truly understand an incredible part of wrestling history.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much again for taking time to speak to me, and like I said, I'm on my journey now of the trilogy, and I can't wait to get to One Fall to a Finish. Eventually, I'm a very slow reader, but I'll get there eventually. But I can't wait. Again, thank you very much.
Thank you, Billy. Thanks very much for that.